the sanctuary, since that's our theme. It's hard to find songs on the sanctuary. I don't run across very many. There are a few.
Really enjoyed all the messages I've heard so far and really been blessed by them. We want to go to the Lord in prayer at this time, and that's all we'll kneel and pray at this time. Our Father in heaven, we come at this place and time in the camp meeting, and we're grateful and glad to be here, and for everyone who is here that will hear the presentation and the rest of the messages that will be here spoken at this camp meeting. While we're very blessed, and we know this as a people, we're living in a typical day of the atonement, and there's many souls are perishing. Help us to be instruments in your hand, Father. Help us to speak the words of truth, the words of life. And whatever we present, Father, to your children, we pray that they will be receptive, to have an open heart and open mind. And Father, without that, we know the doors might be closed to them. But we want to pray in advance before we even talk to anybody that the Lord has a message for everyone, a message of salvation. And we want to be able to be part of the message, Father. Send Jesus to help us to speak. Give us his spirit, the spirit that you give him without measure. And we thank you for coming so far down to us to reach us each one. And we ask, Father, that you'll carry us all into your kingdom. By your grace, we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Preparations. I got much to want to say today, and I want to start out with a spirit of prophecy quote, and the reason I want to do this, I heard one of our brothers speak about this yesterday from early writings. And the spirit of prophecy was given to the church as a light, not the greatest light, but a light that will help us on a path.
Amen.
When I hear someone speak about the spirit of prophecy, even though they're Adventists and whatever their present condition is in, how they think, it makes me want to search what that spirit of prophecy says. And when you hear something that's taken out of context, it kind of makes me wonder about those people. Now, Mrs. White, at times her words are misunderstood. And especially those outside the church will be easy for those people to misunderstand what Mrs. White actually was saying. And I want to try to clarify. The reason I'm going to do this, because I've heard in the Lunar Sabbath groups use Mrs. White's writings against her, against the truth, against God's Spirit. And this is one of the things that I'm going to bring up at this present time, because I feel like it's very important. Now, it was mentioned yesterday, this is page 33 of early writings, and the subtopic is subsequent vision. But I want to start down here on the bottom page, last paragraph on page 33, if you want to make a count of that. She says, I saw that God had children who did not see and keep the Sabbath. They had not rejected the light upon it. And at the commencement of the time of trouble, we were filled with the Holy Ghost as we went forth to proclaim the Sabbath more fully. This enraged the churches and the nominal Adventists, as they could not refute the Sabbath truth. And at this time, God chose all saw clearly that we had the truth, and they came out and endured persecution with us. Now, Lunar Sabbath believers, some of them I know have been Seventh-day Adventists. I don't know what they'll be at the end of time or their time or when the end of the world comes or whatever. But they have used this text to try to say that the Lunar Sabbath is going to bring you to the truth about the Sabbath. So you may hear this in the future. Now, the little explanation on page 85 of this little book, her view, she says, this view was given in 1847 when there were but a few of Adventist brethren observing the Sabbath. This is the beginning of the movement, isn't it?
Amen.
And of these, but a few supposed that its observance was sufficient importance to draw a line between the people of God and unbelievers. At the time that was written, it was early in the work. And this has been taken out of context. And her writings to us are very precious. And I really don't believe that we can justify what I just said people are going to be saying in the future. And I got a dear brother that I love so much. He believes that. He believes it so wholeheartedly that the Lunar Sabbath is going to bring us out to the truth when we already have the truth. The Sabbath comes every seventh day, and that will be my story to them. So I just want to alert you to that, because you may hear it in the future. So today we're going to continue in our study.
Could you read just the next sentence from that note in earlier on page 85? I think it helps to build the case a little stronger, and I hate to take your time, but if you do that for me.
Okay. I just read where it says between the people of God and the unbelievers. Now, the fulfillment of that view is beginning to be seen. The commencement of that time of trouble here mentioned does not refer to the time when the plague shall begin to be poured out, but a short period just before they are poured out while Christ is in the sanctuary.
But the first part of that sentence, she says, this is already being seen. And what she's referring to is the Sabbath being preached more fully is already being seen in her time. As they were understanding the Sabbath better, preaching it better, and it wasn't making any kind of a reference to a moon Sabbath later.
That's right. No reference whatsoever.
And I found no references of a lunar Sabbath in any of her earlier or any of the pioneers.
They're not there. This is a man-made doctrine, I would say, more devilish than what man really knows about it. But we want to continue our study. We're in Exodus years now. Some more about this kind of cycle that I've been looking at in Scripture and also in the calendar. In 25:13, this was the third year of a cycle of 7 years. And what I mean by that, if you look up here, you'll see that this line right here, this red line, will show you 7 complete years. This is the first cycle. In those 7 years, you got 2,520 days. That's an interesting number, isn't it? You know, at the time when Christ was crucified, between 27 and 34, how many years do you think you had? Just throw that up for a suggestion. You had 7 years. All right, the first cycle. Then when this ends here, this first cycle, the 7 years ends, you'll see that two there. Automatically, the next one will be 7. It starts out the same way, 7531642, 731616. You'll see at times, in some years, you'll have 52 Sabbaths. Some of them you'll have 51. Now this was a 24-year from creation down that I made this chart. I hope everybody can see it. If not, I'll just stand aside a little bit. But anyway, in all these years, the 24 years here, we had only 288 new moons. But the Sabbath, you had how many? You had 1,228. Now, if you had all these days up, that's a great number of days for that many years. But I thought this was very important through my studies. And when I looked at it, we had a great number of days there, a whole lot of days. But it just goes to prove to me that those new moons were not as important as the Sabbath, you see. There's many days and many years. But when I looked at all my studying about the calendar situation from creation down, it helped me to see the greater importance, and that is the seventh-day Sabbath. The Sabbath is the anchor of all time. It wouldn't do no good to have many years about the Sabbath or many months, but the Sabbath is the anchor. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, we're going to do a little review. This is the first year of the Exodus when they left Egypt, and I mentioned the 15th day of being an important day in Scripture. It is, you know, it's mentioned in chapter 19, it's actually mentioned in chapter 16 of Exodus. And when they came out on the 15th in chapter 12. So you got 3 months in a row where the 15th day is mentioned. But what is the importance of the 15th day? It is the first day of a feast here in the first month. There's no feast actually in the second month. And in the third month, there's no feast. That next feast that you'll see, if you had one at this time, would be Pentecost. But we didn't have a Pentecost feast in the third month. They wasn't ready for that. There's many things that lunar Sabbath people tried to crowd in those 3 months. They want to crowd the feast in. which they have never gotten yet. They want a crown of Pentecost, tabernacles, and all that, right in those 3 months. They want to teach those 3 months to you. And it's spread out over many years. It's an important fact to state that they cannot, with truthfulness, tell you that all these things were in those first 3 months, because they did not exist at that time. They were given later at a later date. And we'll talk about that later. So we have, as you see, the cycles here that still works together. We have our Sabbath intact at the end of each week. That new moon does nothing for the Sabbath. It has no control. God established that as a monthly marker. A new moon is a monthly marker. The weekly marker is our Sabbath, with the first day going to the seventh, and that is what Scripture teaches me. Let's go to the next one. The second month, chapter 16 of Exodus, is an important month to, at this time, we want to talk about. Now, you see where the 15th day is? The 15th day here in this particular month would be a Sabbath, because it fell on a Sabbath. And that day right there is the first day of unleavened bread. You would call that a high day. Just like you do over there in the New Testament when they were talking about this was a high day. I think it's in chapter 19 of, I think it's John. And when I looked at that, well, I see here's a high day and here's a high day. If the 14th was Passover and the first day of unleavened bread, that would make that a high day. The 21st is the last day of unleavened bread. Or it would be in the first month. I'm sorry, this is the second month. But anyway, the 15th day here is a Sabbath. And this is one of the months that they like to use to proclaim lunar Sabbath. Because this particular time, it would be a 15th day of the month, also a Sabbath. But you can see how the Sabbaths run after they got their manna on the 16th. They also had their quail on the evening after the 15th. Now, if I would put the evenings on here, it would make it a little bit clearer. And you would shade in half a day to give you a view of the evening and then the morning. And then when the evening came after the 15th, it would be into the 16th period of time. When they got in the evening, they got their quail. But in the morning, they got their one omer of manna on the 16th, and it just carried right over here till you got double on the 21st, and you found none on the Sabbath. If you back up from here and go into the first month, you'll see that those Sabbaths have different numbers. When you go forward, your Sabbath in the next month will have also different numbers, because the days of the weeks and the months, the cycles interlock. They have cycles that meet each other. And when it comes to that point, go to the next one, please. You'll see you have different numbers here, but it is still the seventh-day Sabbath. That is clear to me now as it ever could be. And this particular month, on the 15th day, you'll see it's over here now. That is the sixth-day marker. That's the third month, the third 15th day of those 3 months where they come out of Egypt. That's all it is. There's nothing really significant about those monthly markers to me, not now. It used to be a little different thought. But we're going to be looking in this particular month. We've got a lot to look at. Moses, on the 15th day, when they come to Mount Sinai, it's okay to set up camp if it's the 15th day, because it's not a Sabbath, is it? Now, lunar Sabbath people would say you could not set up on a Sabbath, a lunar Sabbath, but really, is it a lunar Sabbath? The point is, it's not. But this is the day that Moses goes up, and the Lord tells Moses to prepare the people for 3 days. We're going to have a meeting in 3 days. And in those 3 days, they were prepared, their clothes to be washed, all the preparation to be made for the meeting. And this is an important meeting. This is the beginning of him giving all the commandments, the statutes, and the judgments, and all the particulars that are specifically mentioned about God's commandments. Moses, our prophet, Israel's prophet, was used of the Lord. And you know, I really, when I study about Moses, at times I feel like I'm a type of Moses. You know, I'm trying to present truth, and to particular people in my family, I want them to really take another look at this, because I think where they have, I've left them in a position where I need to go back and help them. Moses is one of my best individuals or characters in the Bible I like to study about. Now I'm going to turn this chart right here, and I'm going to show you a drawing I did. And this is not the greatest drawing in the world, but it is a image of what I have seen. This is one of the first things I draw from Scripture to try to illustrate this particular month. And I want to move this back just a little bit if I can, so people can see this. And I'll try to stay to one side. Now, this here? Yeah. Now, as you read Scripture, especially in Exodus, if you go to chapter 19, please. We want to get some text on this, and it's very important. In the third month, chapter 19, verse 1, when the children of Israel gone forth out of the land of Egypt, the same day they came into the wilderness of Sinai. This is just a drawing that I took and made from what I've read in Scripture. And this will tell us about the whole month, the third month of the Exodus. When they came down here to Mount Sinai, they came to the foot of the mountain. They could not touch the mountain. They were supposed to put a border around it to keep any from touching that mountain. It was so sacred, so holy ground, that nobody but those who had permission could go up. And this picture here is just a illustration. It's nothing really beautiful about it, but there is a lot of beautiful things about it. I'm not really an artist or anything, but this is important in this teaching. And it says, and they were departed from Rephidim, and they were come to the desert of Sinai, and had pitched in the wilderness, and there Israel camped before this mount here. In verse 2, and Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called unto him out of the mount, saying, thus shalt thou say unto the house of Jacob, and tell the children of Israel. He has gone over some history here, they're repeating some history that he had helped these Israelites through this in their bondage and bring them out. He says, you have seen what I have done unto the Egyptians, and how I bear you on eagle's wings, and brought you unto myself. There, he's brought him to this mountain. You know, we hear a lot about God's mountain, Mount Sinai, at this time. And you have seen all I have done to the Egyptians. Now, therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people of all the earth. What a precious blessing that would have been. And if you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, these are the words which thou shalt speak unto the children of Israel. Important words. And Moses came and called the elders of the people and laid before their faces all these words which the Lord commanded him. And all the people answered together and said, all the Lord has said or spoken we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Moses, lo, I come unto thee in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with thee, and believe thee forever. And Moses told the words of the people unto the Lord. Now, when you read this, you have to kind of picture everything going on. Moses getting his information. You know, there's different parts of this story that we have to kind of put in place. You know, it's like telling a story and you got things out of place, but when you put them in place, it makes the perfect picture. What does the picture do? It will speak a thousand words. Many things can be learned by pictures, but anyway, we want to go on. And if you read chapter 19 down to chapter 35 and read it and try to understand what's going on, it will be beneficial to you. Now, Moses is instructed to get the people ready within 3 days. I chose those 3 days after the 15th, and that was the 16th, 17th, and the 18th. And of course, Moses and the children of Israel, they come to the foot of the mountain on the 15th. You know, they set up their camp. And Moses goes up, gets the people ready within 3 days. I believe the 18th would have been the third day of that meeting. How will I know that? As the story unfolds, we'll see. On the third day, we know that he came down and he starts speaking all the words that Moses wrote down. And in chapter 20, it says, And God spake all these words, saying, I am the Lord thy God, which had brought thee out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. And he goes into the commandments, but he also says some other words too, and I'd like to read the first part of this chapter 20. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image or likeness anything that is in the heavens. What about the new moon? We don't want to bow down to any heavenly spheres up there. Or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the waters under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them or serve them. If you're serving something, you're going to be, what? You may worship that if you're serving that, right? So if you're using something other than what he established, you may be an adult, you know, idolater. And he says here, for the Lord thy God I am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon children to the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Amen. That says volumes to me. Amen. But if you go on and start reading all these chapters, and you come up to chapter 24, we're going to see some things that happen here in chapter 24. Now, the 18th day I had spoken that this was the meeting day, and they were at the foot of the mountain. You see some of the tents here. Now, Moses, in the wilderness, he had a temporary tent that was set up. We call it the tent of the congregation. And it's before they got the sanctuary. Moses would go to that when there was questions to be asked of the Lord, and he would come down, and he would visit him and speak to him at the door tent. And if you had any problems, you came to Moses, he got your answers for you there. It was a temporary setup, and Moses has a temporary tent. Now, this is just a tent I got on here, and this demonstrates what I was saying. Now, after the 18th day, Moses has instructed the people all through this, especially around the 18th day, when they saw all the demonstrations that God had done on Mount Sinai. The thunder, the lightning, and the speaking was loud. And, you know, they were very fearful. They even come to a point and told Moses, you speak with us, but don't let him speak with us any longer, because we're fearful that we may even die. It was a demonstration, really, to wake them up to see how holy that God really is.
Brother Allen,
yes.
Why were they fearful? Because they saw in themselves the sins that they had? Is that what was going on? Because Moses didn't seem to be.
No, Moses does not seem to be. That's a good point. I feel like those people was a mixed multitude. Being a mixed multitude of people, you know, it's really a trouble. Yeah. We don't want to be a mixed multitude. We all want to be one in Christ and have one Father. But these people here, they have different backgrounds. And problem with sin, you know, they came out of a place. It's just full of sin. Egypt was, we're not to go back to Egypt. We've heard that today, and in meetings past probably. We're not to go back to Egypt for anything, not for counsel especially. Anyway, on the 19th day, early in the morning, Moses rises up early in the morning. He builds an altar. I got 12 stones here. You can barely see it, I know, from a distance. But he did build an altar. He had the young men to take oxen and shed the blood because they're going to have an offering here. He also takes that blood, puts it in a basin, and he does some different things with the blood. He sprinkles blood on the altar. He also takes the blood and sprinkles it on the people. Would you move that a couple? Okay, this is the foot of Mount Sinai. It's a better little picture, but this is the foot of Mount Sinai in chapter 19, the 3 days of preparation we're talking about now, the 18th day of that month, fifth day of the week, by the way. Fifth day of the week. The 18th was the fifth day of the week. So, in Exodus 19 through, actually, chapter 35 of Exodus, this whole story unfolds. These people come to Mount Sinai, and they get themselves ready. On the 18th day, they have this meeting. And then on the 19th, he rises up early, as I said before, and he has the altar, he builds the altar, and the blood is shed, and the blood is caught, and also the sprinkling of the altar, and the people, and the covenant, the book of the covenant. It's all this takes place on the 19th day. So this is part of the week that I'm talking about here. And it will unfold even farther. Now, after this 19th day, if you read the story of Moses, there's a lot to be read about this. And Patriarchs and Prophets, 304 through 316 in some of your books, it will tell you about this story somewhat, but you have to kind of use scripture with it to get a full picture. I've been through that quite a bit. Now the next day, after the 19th day, when the 19th day is finished here, Moses, in the next morning, and let's go back to chapter 24 of Exodus. I want to pick up the story right here. And he said unto Moses, come up unto the Lord, thou and Aaron, Nebat, and Abihu, and 70 of the children of Israel, and worship afar off. Worship. He mentions worship here. That's an important aspect of what we do when we worship God, right? He says to worship afar off. And Moses alone shall come near the Lord, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people come up with him. And Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words which the Lord have said we will do. Now they made a covenant, you see. And back here on that day, the 19th day, it was sprinkled with blood. It was sealed at that time, you might say. And Moses wrote all the words of the Lord and rose up early in the morning. Now, if he rises up after this is done, the next day is going to be your 20th day. This is would be a Sabbath, actually. 18, 19, 20. 20th day of the month, 7th day of the week. And Moses takes those 70 elders, he takes Aaron, his sons, and Joshua, his minister, and they go up. This level right here is the first level that I have got on this mountain. I kept this kind of bare so we could see it a little bit better. They go up to a first level on this mountain. He says, come up and bring these people with you, these 70 elders and Aaron, his sons. And they come up and they worship afar off. Where's he at? Where's her father at? And son. We're up here on top of the mountain. But they're in, you know, they're here by those people too. I mean, God can be anywhere at any time. But here we have a first level of the mountain, I would say. And here we have the worship afar off. And we go and read some more about this. It says when in verse 9, and when and went up Moses and Aaron and Abat and Bayu and the 70 children, 70 elders of Israel. And they saw God of Israel, and there was under his feet like a paved work of a sapphire stone, and as it were the body of heaven in its clearness. And upon the nobles of the children of Israel he laid not his hand, also they saw God and did eat and drink. Now what was eating and drinking? This is Sabbath day. On the sixth day you got two omers of manna. You kept one for the Sabbath, didn't you? So this is what they're doing now. There's a little stream here, as you can see, the blue. They gather water and they drink water there also. They're up here having this meeting, and they're having a good time too. Now, go to the next slide for me. Now here, if we go back, I should have went back on the 19th day. This is the sprinkling of the people, and you see the altar and the covenant there, the scroll and the blood, and also the tent that Moses would come in, commune with the Father there. And let's go to the next one. And here we are. This is the meeting on top of this first level here. 70 elders with Moses on Mount Sinai. And you see the text. That's Exodus 24, 1 and 2, and also 9 through 11. This is the 20th day of the third month, which is a Sabbath, and you also have Aaron, his sons, with him. Now, there's going to be some changes. This, at the end of this day, when Moses is going to go up to another level, and he's going to take his minister Joshua with him. And the Lord said unto Moses, come up unto me into the mount, verse 12, and be there. And I will give thee tables of stone and a law and commandments which I have written, that thou mayest teach them. Every one of these commandments need to be taught. And Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mount of God. Now he goes up, not all the way to the top at this point, but he goes up to the next level. And there's a reason for that. This level right here, only two people up here. Now before he leaves the first level and goes up, he tells Aaron and the rest of them to wait here until we return. He says in verse 14, and he said unto the elders, tarry here for us until we come again unto you, and behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. And Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount. Now, before Moses goes up, he tells them to wait until we return. But does he do that? What does Aaron actually do after this?
He builds a calf.
He goes down to the people, the multitudes of God's people, mixed multitude, and they want to have something to worship. They want to see something. They want to see a God. They want a God to take them back to Egypt. You know. So this is Aaron going back down. You know, I think about it. If he didn't go back down, he stayed there and waited on Moses, he wouldn't have built that. He would not have built that. But now we have Moses and Joshua going up, and there's 6 days of preparation that we want to talk about. It's very important. And I believe after the 20th day, you normally would count 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26. So the days of preparation are right here. Moses and Joshua is here, and they have 6 days of preparation. After he tells the elders, tarry here for us until we come again unto you, and behold, Aaron and Hur with you. And Moses went up, in verse 16, the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it for 6 days. And on the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now Moses, as patriarchs and prophets tells us, that he had to have a time of preparation. And there were 6 days involved. These 6 days, I declare to you, that it be the 21st to the 26th of this month. This is the third month. This story is unfolding, and as you Understand we have 6 days of work, don't we? 6 days of preparation for the Sabbath. So it's no different with Moses. He is Israel's leader. He is doing what the Lord tells him to do. So he has his 6 days of preparation, and here we have his minister Joshua with him. They're drinking water and they're eating the manna. Now, at this point, this will be the last food that Moses is going to eat for a long period of time. After this 6 days is all with, he calls Moses up into the mount on the seventh day Sabbath, which will be the 27th of the month. This is the third month. This is also beginning of the 40 days of Moses and the 40 nights. In the third month, the 27th day. Can you see that? I hope you can. This timeline works really well if you follow these months, 3 months in a row. This works out perfectly. And in the, when Moses is up here for those 40 days and 40 nights, he receives the Ten Commandments. And he don't take these stones up this time, but he does the second time. He goes up there, and those stones are cut out of the mountain, and the writing of God is on those stones. And nothing else is on those stones but the writing of God. What is that writing? The Ten Commandments. You know, I've heard a lot of people say, well, there's a lot more writing on the Ten Commandments stones, but I tell you, I just don't believe it's there. It's not there. You'll hear that probably from some of your Lunar Sabbath keepers that, what's writing on both sides? Sure. God's finger burnt those things into them stones. And if it went through the stone, so what? If it's writing on the backside, but what those sides are when you put stones together, you got two sides. There's nothing really on those stones but the Ten Commandments. The third month, the 27th day of the month, begins its 40 days. If you would count to the fifth month, the sixth day of the month, the fourth day of the week, Moses would come out. Now this is Joshua when they're up on 6 days, the preparation. Go to the next one, please. Moses is here on the mountain now, the beginning of his 40 days. And if you look at chapter 24, 15 through 18, and that's the story here. It says, when he goes up into the mount, the cloud covers that mount, and the glory of the Lord abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered 6 days. This is in preparation days. And the seventh day, which he went up into the mount, he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud. And in the sight of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the eyes of all Israel. They're beholding what's going on down here in their camps. They see all the magnificence that's going on being portrayed before their eyes. And Moses went up into the midst of the cloud and got him up into the mount. And Moses was there 40 days and 40 nights. So this story is unfolding. And when Moses is there that length of time, this is will be the date that he comes out. Go ahead. Now, while he's up there on Mount Sinai, if you want to help read this, you can look from where you're at and read it. It says, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my Sabbath you shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doeth sanctify you. Ye shall keep the Sabbath therefore, for it is holy unto you. Everyone that defileth it shall be surely put to death. For whosoever doeth any work therein, that so shall be cut off from the among his people. 6 days may work be done, but in the seventh is the Sabbath of rest, holy to the Lord. Whosoever doeth any work in the Sabbath day, he shall surely be put to death. Therefore the children of Israel shall keep the Sabbath and observe the Sabbath throughout their generations for a perpetual sign, a covenant. It is a sign between me and the children of Israel forever. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, and on the seventh day he rested and was refreshed. And he gave unto Moses when he had made an end of the communing with him upon Mount Sinai two tables of stone, tables of testimony, tables of stone, written with the finger of God. And if you look at the Ten Commandments, you'll see no additions to the Sabbath commandment, the fourth one. There's no additions. It's plain, it's simple, and even a child can understand it. Sometimes when we grow up, we become unchildren-like. And it's really shameful in a lot of ways. We need to believe what the Lord says and only what He says. There's some other texts there that can go along with that if you want to write them down there. Exodus 31, 12 through 18, Exodus 23, 12, and Luke 13, 14. The first 40 days of Moses up on the mountain, when he comes out, what does he find? You know how the story goes. Aaron has made a calf. They're having a party. They're having a celebration, aren't they? Now Moses is very, I believe Moses was a righteous man. He was a humble man. And to see and know what was going on, he was warned before he came down, 32. Yeah. And the people saw that Moses delayed to come down out of the mountain. And the people gathered themselves together unto Aaron and said unto him, come up, make us gods which shall go before us. Whereas this Moses, the man which brought us up out of the land of Egypt, we wot not what become of him. And Aaron said unto them, break off your earrings which are on your ears of your wives and your sons and your daughters, and bring them unto me. And all the people broke off the golden earrings which were in their ears and brought them unto Aaron. And he received them at their hand and fashioned it in a graving tool, with a graving tool, after he had made it a golden calf. And they said, these be thy gods, O Israel, which brought thee up out of the land of Egypt. And Aaron saw it, he built an altar before it, and Aaron made proclamation and said, tomorrow is a feast unto the Lord. Now, who told him to make that proclamation? Nobody. Here's another point that you need to realize. Lunar Sabbath keepers will tell you this is Pentecost. Or they'll have some other explanation for this, proclaiming tomorrow is a feast. Believe it, it's not a feast whatsoever. It's Aaron proclaiming something that's really their feast, not the Lord's. It's not the Lord's feast. He's not going to have something made to worship other than Himself. You know, it's just not. It's not biblical.
Brother Allen,
yes.
Did they make this golden calf on Friday?
Okay, the day that Moses comes down.
At the Sabbath, right?
He comes down 40 days. Now, the 40th day that he comes down will be the fifth month, sixth day of the month, fourth day of the week. That's when he comes down. I've done a timeline on this. If you want to do it, you can. You'll have some additional help, hopefully. If this is what the Lord showed me. Now, when he come down, he broke those stones because, was he justified in doing it? They were not worthy of these Ten Commandments at this time. They had broke everything before he even received it. So they're not worthy to receive the Ten Commandments. So Moses throws them down, and they're broken. That's why he's got to take two more stones back up. When he goes up, in the fifth month, the seventh day of the month, the fifth day of the week, that's when he goes back up. I just wanted to point that out at this time. When he stays there another 40 days, and he comes back out, of those four, the last 40 days, which will total to 80, the sixth month, 16th day of the month, second day of the week, and that is in chapter 34. That was going to earlier, which I hadn't, shouldn't have went there. But anyway, that will conclude the 80 days when Moses went up there on the 27th day of the third month and comes out, sixth month, 16th day of the month, second day of the week. If you want to do a time limit, you can. I've been over this story so many times, even in my sleep. I went up on Mount Sinai with Moses because it was so important to me to prove to myself really what was going on in this story. Was it lunar Sabbath they were keeping? No. It was the seventh day of the week. And for me, I am satisfied. What I just showed you, this whole story right here unfolds in those chapters. Until I put the calendar in use, I was sort of in the dark. But you can go through this program and look at these different dates and stuff that's in Scripture. Well, not in Scripture, but in the calendar that was showed you here. This has been a big help for me. And when Moses comes off in this month, you know, when he comes off with a vast lot of knowledge. He's got the sanctuary in his mind. He's got it pictured what it's going to be look like. It is a picture of the sanctuary that we all study. And they're going to build a sanctuary from this point on. Your 5.5 months will take you into the end of the year, will make up the difference of that year. And when they come to the end of the year and in the next year, when it's set up on the first day, and we want to look at that. Go ahead to the next slide, please. Now this is a picture of what Aaron did. He built a golden calf to worship. The fifth month, sixth day of the month. The fifth month, sixth day of the month. The fourth day of the week, Moses comes off the mountain. That's the first 40 days. The fifth month, the seventh day of the month, the fifth day of the week, Moses returns to Mount Sinai. He goes right up the next morning. Why did he go up? He's going to make an atonement, perhaps for the people, because this great sin that's been committed. And Moses, he pleads with the Father when he goes up there. Father, these people that you had brought out of Egypt, they were your people. He's begging for mercy here. And he does get mercy. But he says, if there's going to be any punishment, to be ones that are guilty. And, you know, as the story folds up, when they even go into the land of Canaan, most of those folks don't make it across. Anyway, we want to continue on. The second 40 days and nights, in the 6 months, 16th day of the month, second day of the week, the 80 days, from the third month to 27th day, that's when it all started. So if you read chapters 32 through 35, this story here is on the board, and I'm glad to be able to share it with you. Let's go to the next slide. This is the fourth month. Moses hasn't come down yet, as we know. He don't really come down until the fifth month, and this is just the fourth month. Go to the next slide, please. You can see the Sabbaths are still where they're at, and the new moons are still where they're supposed to be. And in this fifth month here, you see, I have Moses returns, and he sees the golden calf. And Moses, the next morning, and they also get their omers. You see that? The manna is still falling from the second month. They get that every week for 6 days, and then they have a Sabbath where they won't get any omers. And that omer will fall on New Moon Day. It's not such a precious day at all. It's not a Sabbath. It's only the beginning of the month. Now, on this sixth day here, Moses comes down, he sees the calf, he returns back up. It takes two tables of stone in this particular month. Let's go to the next slide. In this month here, Moses comes off Mount Sinai. This is the end of the 80 days, Exodus 34:29. You can see on the first day of the week, new moon's right there, and then the Sabbath is the seventh day. This calendar right here, you can take it right back to Genesis 1. It fits perfectly. Let's go to the next slide. The building of the tabernacle, while Moses was on Mount Sinai, received the instructions to build a tabernacle. Passover was given in the scripture the second year of the first month. Now they had actually three Passovers. The last one was when they crossed the Jordan with Joshua. Moses wasn't with them at that time, but the first Passover was in Egypt. They came out on the 15th day. And then the second year, they had another Passover, and they had that on the 14th day of the month. We're going to look at that month and see what day of the week it fell on. The tabernacle took about 5.5 months to build. From the 6th month to 17th day, the day that he came off Mount Sinai, to the first month of the next year, Exodus 40, verses 1 and 2, and 17 and 18. Numbers 1, 1. Let's look at the first text there, Exodus 40. It says in verse 1, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, on the first day of the month thou shalt set up the tabernacle of the tent of the congregation, and thou shalt put therein the ark of the testimony, and cover the ark with the veil. And thou shalt, as in chapter 40, verse 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 says, and thou shalt bring in the table and set in order the things that are to be set in order upon it. And thou shalt bring in the candlestick and the light of the lamps thereof, and light the lamps thereof. Over in verse 17 of this chapter, it says, and it came to pass in the first month of the second year, on the first day of the month, that the tabernacle was reared up. And Moses reared up the tabernacle and fastened the sockets and set it up the boards thereof and put in the bars thereof and reared up its pillars. Let's go to the next one. There's no lunar Sabbath in this study, folks. Here is a picture of its tabernacle set up. And I gave you the picture here because I wanted you to see it. You know, it's a very interesting study when you study the tabernacle. And this is already in operation, of course. But this was set up at that particular time, the second year, first day of the month, and first day of the week. You see how these kind of work together, these cycles? They're working together. They do what they're supposed to do from creation. Let's go to the next one. And this is the seventh month. We haven't got to the first year yet. This is just the seventh month. Now, if they would have had tabernacles out there, this would have been the month they would have had it. Did they have tabernacles out there in the wilderness? No. But lunar Sabbath people said, yeah, we have tabernacles at this time. They can't have it at this time.
What do they use to say they had tabernacles in the wilderness? Do they use any Bible texts or?
No. I never seen any. They imagine it happened, you might say. But as you can see here, if this would have been the time of tabernacles, the seventh month, this would have been the month they would have done it in. The first day of the month would have been the day of trumpets. We know the story about trumpets. 10 days to the day of atonement. They didn't have that out there at this time. And they loved this 15th and the 8th day when you talk about tabernacles, because they proclaimed the 15th and the 22nd a Sabbath, a lunar Sabbath. The moons may fall on those particular days, but it doesn't make a Sabbath. It's just another luminary out there doing its work. Anyway, you have a Sabbath at the end here where it's supposed to be. The building of the tabernacle is still going on. Those people have been trained to do this by the Lord. The next slide, please. The 15th to 21st tabernacles at this time. No, we don't have one at this time. If you want to look at Leviticus and read about those feasts of the Lord, you can. These are the Lord's appointed festivals, which are to be proclaimed as sacred assemblies for bringing food offerings to the Lord. Food offerings. Yeah. Burn offerings, grain offerings, sacrifice, drink offerings required for each day. These offerings are in addition to those of the Lord's Sabbath. Very important point. The seventh-day Sabbath and those feast Sabbaths, which that's what they are, they haven't a feast on those days. It's kept as a Sabbath, but it's called a Sabbath in Scripture, and it's not a seventh-day Sabbath. If you look at the Hebrew, you see there's two different numbers there, and it's not the seventh-day Sabbath. But they proclaim that these are lunar Sabbaths, as because they're the 15th and the 22nd of the month. That falls into line with the new moon being the 8, 1, 8 15, 22, 29 days of the month. So that's what they do. Besides, you know, these Sabbaths here that's mentioned at this time, they don't want to recognize that text. They don't want to because they know they're shooting themselves in the foot when they keep these lunar Sabbaths. These offerings, in addition to the Lord's Sabbath, and in addition to the gifts and whatever you have vowed and all the free will offerings you give unto the Lord. So beginning with the 15th day of the seventh month, you are to have gathered a crop of the land. Celebrate the festival to the Lord for 7 days. The first day is a day of the Sabbath rest. A day of the Sabbath rest. It's not a holy Sabbath. The eighth day shall also be a day of the Sabbath rest. On the first day you are to take branches. First day, remember, 15th. Take the branches of luxurious trees from palm, willow, and leafy trees, and rejoice before the Lord your God 7 days. Celebrate this as a festival of the Lord for 7 days each year. How many times a year are they supposed to gather? 3 times a year. If you read those chapters in Exodus, it says, all males have come before me 3 times a year, present themselves, and don't come empty-handed. So these festivals are celebrated 3 times a year. On the first day, you shall take the branches. We just mentioned that. Celebrate this, a festival to the Lord, 7 days each year. This is to be a lasting ordinance for the generations to come, celebrated in the seventh month. Live in temporary shelters for 7 days. All native-born Israelites are to live in such shelters. In verse 43, and so your descendants will know that I have had the Israelites live in temporary shelters when I brought them out of Egypt. I am the Lord your God. Holy convocations, yes. Annual Sabbaths of the year, yes. But not seventh-day Sabbaths, not always. Now, it will happen when it's supposed to happen. When those cycles fall into alignment, you'll have a high Sabbath. And these feasts can make that so, like it did at the time when Christ was crucified, when the first day of unleavened bread fell on the holy Sabbath day, the seventh day of the week. They call it the high day. So that's what I was trying to bring to you to understand. Let's go to the next slide. And it says in verse 33, Leviticus, and the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, speak unto the children of Israel, saying, the 15th day of this seventh month shall be a feast of tabernacles for 7 days unto the Lord. On the first day you shall have, or shall be a holy convocation. You shall do no servile work. 7 days you shall offer an offering made before unto the Lord. On the eighth day shall be a holy convocation unto you. It's not a Sabbath, it's just a holy convocation at this time. And you shall offer an offering made before unto the Lord. It is a solemn ceremony, and you shall do no work, servile work therein. These are the feasts of the Lord, which ye shall proclaim to be holy convocations, to offer an offering made before unto the Lord, a burnt offering, a meat offering, a sacrifice, a drink offering, everything upon his day. Besides the Sabbaths of the Lord. Very important text. Besides your free gifts, besides all your vows, besides all your free will offerings, you shall give unto the Lord. Let's go to the next one. Also in the 15th day of the seventh month, when you shall gather in the fruit of the land, you shall keep a feast unto the Lord 7 days. And on the first day shall be a Sabbath, and on the eighth day shall be a Sabbath. If you look at the Hebrew on this, you'll see there's a difference. The numbers are not the same. The number for Shabbat is 7676, and one for this type of Sabbath, a Sabbath, is a Shabbaton, which is 7677. You can look that up and see what the difference might be. So that's enough for the, I believe, of this right here. We can see what Scripture says. Let's go to the next one. Here's the eighth month. Tabernacle still under construction. And you still see where the new moon is. We have the cycle of the weeks, the month. Go to the next one. Same thing here. Gomer is still coming every 6 days, double on six, Noah and on Sabbath. Next one. I'll back up one. And here again, if you back up, here again we have the first day of the month falling on the Sabbath. Well, that's a Sabbath day. You can't cut it no other way. And it would be right for lunar Sabbath people to believe that. It would fall right into their thinking. But it doesn't make that new moon any more than what it is. It's just a phase of a cycle. First day of the month. The Sabbath would have fell right there. You would have had five Sabbaths in this month. Some months you only have four. Now if you have a lunar reckoning, you'll have less Sabbaths in a year than you would if you had a solar lunar calendar from creation. Go to the next one. This is the 10th month. We're still waiting on the tabernacle to be built. Go ahead, next one. 11th month, same way. You still see the phases and all that going, the cycles. Next one. Here we have the first year of Exodus, the last month of the first year of Exodus. This year was 2513. My calculation, that was the year, and I've seen other proofs that would be also. This particular month, there's not more going on than what we've seen in the others. Go to the next one. This year here is the first month. This is 2514. Naturally, it would be after 2513. The first day of this month, Moses rears up his tabernacle here for Israel on chapter 40 of Exodus, verse 17, as we read earlier. And here, look where the Passover is. Remember, I told you it falls on Sabbath to be a high day? This would be a high day. The 21st would be a high day. Now, there's a difference in really looking at the biblical calendar and facing the real truth and issues about these feasts. You'd have a high day here, a high day there. You would have your 7 days of unleavened bread starting on the 15th, the first day of the week, coming across to the 6th day, the 20th day. That would be the double portion of manna also. That would be your last day of unleavened bread. Well, 21st would be. But anyway, you can see how the Sabbath would fall differently in different years with these feasts. Let's go to the next one. The second year of Exodus, second month, in Numbers 10, this is one month I really would be glad to discover. If we go to Numbers, I'll tell you why. Numbers chapter 10. I like to share this chapter with my brother, and he gets pretty frustrated with me sometimes. But anyway, if we look at these verses here, verses 11 and verses 33. Now, at this time, Moses is instructed, if you read the story, that it's time to leave Mount Sinai. They've been there long enough. You've heard that when you read scripture, and you may read spirit prophecy. They've been there all this time since they left Egypt, and this is the second year, and in the second month, he tells them that they're going to go on a journey. In verse 11 of chapter 10 of Numbers, it says, "It came to pass on the 20th day of the second month in the second year that the cloud was taken up from off the tabernacle of the congregation. And the children of Israel took their journeys out of the wilderness of Sinai, and the cloud rested in the wilderness of Paran. And they first took their journey according to the commandment of the Lord by the hand of Moses." Over in verse 33 now, it says, "And Moses said unto," how do you pronounce that name? Okay. Moses said unto Hubba, I can't pronounce the name really, and Ragu, and verse 29. I'm going to start a little early in verse 33. I'm sorry. Verse 29, and he says unto Hubba, the son of Ragu, the Midianite, Moses' father-in-law, "We are journeying unto the place of which the Lord said, I will give it you, come thou with us, and we will do thee good. For the Lord has spoken good concerning Israel. And he said unto him, I will not go, but I will depart to my own land and to my own kindred. And he said, leave us not, I pray thee, for as much as thou knowest how we are encamped in the wilderness, and thou mayest be to us instead of eyes. And it shall be, if thou go with us, yea, it will be that what goodness the Lord shall do unto us, the same will be done to thee. And they departed from the mount of the Lord 3 days' journey. And this is the point I want to come to. And the ark of the covenant of the Lord went before them in the 3 days' journey to search out a resting place for them. Now back in verse 11 of this chapter, it says, and it came to pass on the 20th day. All right, here we have the 20th day. You can see it there. It's right under 13. The 20th day, they go a 3 days' journey, and they were supposed to go 3 days' journey to find another resting place. So if lunar Sabbaths would be correct, they would be breaking their Sabbath here, because they're going to be traveling on the 20th, the 21st, and the 22nd. So this is one chapter you can go to disprove that lunar Sabbaths are the correct Sabbath to follow. Those 3 days' journey shoots them right in the foot. Mm-hmm. They're not going to travel much like that. Let's go to the next one. The manna started in the first year, the second month, 16th day, first day of the week. Manna ended 41st year, first month, 16th day. We want to go all the way to Jericho with this, and we want to demonstrate how those particular days fall in the calendar. Manna was given one omer manna each day. The day before the Sabbath, they got a double portion, two omers. Manna, 6 days, one was a seventh day Sabbath. Six and one, seven. Manna was given 40 years. Now we look at the year of Moses' life before Joshua became the leader of Israel in Joshua chapter 5. Okay, let's go to the next one. And this year here, if we go back to my other project or my other demonstration, you will see that year will fall out exactly the way you see it here. The first day of that year of the month will be the sixth day of the week. And you can see that when you go through this program. The Sabbath will be the second day. That's the seventh day Sabbath, though, because at the end of that other month, it will work out perfectly for the Sabbath be on the second day of that month. It'll be the seventh day of the week, though. Now, I also want to mention, too, as my study goes, you know, Marion dies in the 40th year, probably around the first month. She's the older sister of Aaron and Moses. And this month here, we don't see a whole lot more, but we want to go a little bit faster now. Let's go to the next one. The same thing here. We see that the cycles and the Sabbath are working. The month is still intact. We don't lose anything. We don't lose no time. The Sabbath is an important issue for me or anybody else. If you want to keep the Sabbath, keep the weekly Sabbath, because that's the day that was appointed in creation. Let's go to the next one. Same thing here. Let's go to the next one. Okay, and this month is a fifth month of the year, of the 40th year, 2553. Aaron dies the first day of that month. And if you want to look in Scripture, and you can find that, it'd be, I don't have it up or do it. I think it was in my notes at the bottom. But anyway, in the fifth month, Aaron dies the first day. You know, they mourned for Aaron for 30 days. He was the high priest. So he dies here at this time. And
that's at Mount Horeb. Was that at Mount Horeb?
At Mount Horeb. And look in Numbers 33, 37, you read on down. And they removed from Kadesh and pitched in the Mount Horeb in the edge of the land of Edom. And Aaron the priest went up into the Mount Horeb at the commandment of the Lord and died there in the 40th year after the children of Israel came out of the land of Egypt in the first day of the fifth month. So here we have Aaron, 120 years old, And he's expiring at this time. He's going to go and be buried with his father, as you might say. So this month was an important month. But Aaron, on the first day of that month, which is a new moon day, and it was also on Sabbath. Is it bad to die on a Sabbath? No, it's not really. Is it bad to die on a new moon day? No, it's not. It's just a new moon and a Sabbath coming together. It's a cycle that fall together. That's exactly what that is. You have 1-8, 15, 22, 29. Sabbath, lunar Sabbath people love this type of calendar. That's all they know. They want to prove everything but that type of calendar has changed. 6 months of this year, there's not much going on. Go to the next one. The 7th month, there is really nothing going on as far as any of the feast that I can determine from Scripture. Let's go to the next one. The 8th month, you see how the changes of the month is and the week still intact. Go to the next one. Here you have the 9th month, the same way. You see how it changes 2 days?
Sorry.
It goes 2 days. Go ahead and change it. One more time. Okay, now it changes way over here in the 11th month. Now this month here is a particular good month to study about. In chapter 34, let's look at chapter 34 of Deuteronomy. Chapter 34, and we're looking at first 9 verses. It says, Moses went up from the plains of Moab unto the mountain of Nebo, to the top of Pisgah, that is over against Jericho. And the Lord showed him all the land of Gilead unto Dan, and all Naphtali, and the land of Ephraim, and Manasseh, and all the land of Judah unto the uttermost sea, and to the south, to the plain of the valley of Jericho, the city of palm trees unto Zoar. And the Lord said unto him, this is the land which I swear unto Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob, saying, I will give it unto thee, I will give it unto thy seed, and I have caused thee to see it with thy eyes, but thou shalt not go over hither. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab, according to the word of the Lord. And they buried him in the valley in the land of Moab, over against Baal Peor. But no man knoweth his sepulchre until this day. And Moses was 120 years old when he died, and his eyes was not dimmed, nor his natural force abated him. And the children of Israel wept for Moses in the plains of Moab 30 days, so the days of weeping and mourning for Moses were ended. And it says in the next verse, and Joshua, the son of Nun, full of the spirit of wisdom, for Moses had laid his hands upon him, and the children of Israel hearkened unto him and did as the Lord commanded Moses. So he became the leader. This month here, Moses spoke to the children of Israel. He rehearsed the history and he told them their future if they did not obey the Lord. What was that?
Isn't it Deuteronomy 4 where he has the blessings and cursings?
Yes. He went through the blessings and the cursings if they didn't follow and do what they were commanded to do. This month here would probably end up Moses' life, but in the 12th month, let's go to the next one. And then in the 12th month, they would mourn for him. This is the end of the 40 years. And Moses has died, and we see that the first day of the month here is a Sabbath. And this whole month they mourn for Moses. They really love Moses. You know, a lot of them maybe not liked him as much, but most of the people love Moses. I love to study about him myself. So this year is the 12th month of that year. And then Joshua is going to take over. And in this next period of time, we want to talk some more about Joshua. Let's change it. Now, in the first month of this year here, the 41st year, why would we go into the 41st year? Would we go in because the manna started in the 2nd month of the first year coming out of Egypt, so we have to determine that month added in to make this equal 40 years. So in this month here, we're coming to a close on this. Now, in this month here, You see where new moon is? It's the second day of the week. The Sabbath here is 6, 13, 20, 27. Now, in this particular month, the Passover is the first day of the week. Now, you see that? How it changes? It doesn't stay in the same place all the time. 15th day is the first day of unleavened bread. That day, after the Passover, they eat the old grain of the land that year. And there's two things happening here in this particular month. They're eating the old grain on the 15th day of the land of Canaan. The next day, there's no more manna. That manna expires. It's the same day that it started 40 years earlier. This is the first month of that year, but you got to use this month here in order to make it equal 40 years. So the manna ceased on the same day it started. You know, it's a monthly date, 40 years to the monthly date, 16th day of the month. But it is the third day of the week. So that's an important thing to realize, that lunar Sabbath, people who believe in lunar Sabbath, they have a different theory about this. They say that manna fell after their lunar Sabbath on the 15th. Well, sorry, that's not the way it really is. Now, also in this particular month, Jericho is going to fall. Now, Josephus, I read Josephus and I like to read Philo, and Josephus talks about this particular time. They put the falling of Jericho on the 21st, but that is the seventh day of the go-around, you see. The first day is the first day of unleavened bread. And I've got Josephus, and I read this, and it's in this program. We may not get that far, but I want you to find Josephus, and you'll find that in the fifth book of Josephus, in the Antiquities of the War, Boards of the Jews. Now, Josephus says, on the first day of Passover, now when you look at the first day of Passover, they kill a lamb on the 14th, and the first day will be actually the next day, from evening all down the next day. That'd be your first day of unleavened bread. He says in there that they went around one time. The second day went around one time until they got down to the seventh day, when they ran around Jericho seven times and the walls fell down. Find Josephus and read it. It's in there. And this, of course, lunar Sabbath people don't believe that Josephus is very liable witness in this. They want to say the next month, the first day of the month, will be the day, if you go to the next month of color. I don't have it. But here's Josephus anyway. Anyway, if you read Josephus, book 5, paragraph 1, chapter 1, paragraph 4, the Hebrews went on further 50 furlongs and pitched their camp at the distance of 10 furlongs in Jericho. But Joshua built an altar of those stones which they all the heads of the tribes at the command of the prophets, the prophet had taken out of the deep, to be hereafter a memorial of the division of the streams of the river. Upon it offered, they offered the sacrifice to God, and in that place celebrated the Passover, and had great plenty of all the things which they had wanted hereto, for they had reaped the corn of the land of Canaan, of the Canaanites, which was now ripe. This is the spring of the year, Passover time, and took out of those things of prey, and then it was that their former food, which was manna, had, which they had, which had they had eaten 40 years, failed them. Next slide. And while the Israelites did this, the Canaanites did not attack them, but they kept themselves quite within their walls. Joshua resolved to besiege them on the first day of the feast of Passover. The priests carried the ark around about, and some part of the armed men to be guards to it. These priests went forward, blowing with the seven trumpets, and exhorted the army to be of good courage, and went around the city, and the Senate followed them, and the priests had only blowed with the trumpets, and they did nothing more at all. They returned to the camp, and they had done for 6 days. On the seventh day, Joshua gathered the armed men and all the people together and told them these good tidings, that the city should be now taken, since God on that day gave it them. by the falling down of the walls, and this of their own accord and without their labor. However, he charged them to kill everyone they should take, and not to sustain from the slaughter of their enemy, either for heavy weariness or for pity, and not to fall on the spoils, and to be therefore diverted from the pursuing their enemies as they ran away, but to destroy all animals and take nothing for their own particular advantage. He commanded them also to bring together all the silver and gold that it might be set apart as the first fruits unto God out of the glorious exploit. And having gotten them from the city, they first took only that what they should have saved Ahab and her kindred alive because of the oath which the spies had sworn unto her. And if you, there's some more to this story. But I want to end it here. And this has been my study for a long time. And I hope you appreciated it. We don't believe in lunar Sabbath anymore, and the proof is in the pudding. But I want to thank you for allowing me to speak here, and I really appreciate y'all's messages that y'all have brought to, and y'all's fellowship, and want you to know we love y'all, and we thank you very much. Let's have prayer at this time. Father in heaven, we want to thank thee. It's been a glorious day, and we know, Father, as we study the truth, and it pleases you for your children to do so. And we want to thank you, Father, for sharing with us the light that you have given us up on Scripture, and using different historical people and different information. It just brings everything together, Father, and we're glad that we could do this, and we ask the blessing upon each one here and the rest of this camp meeting, especially, Father, for all the messages. It's been such good to be here, and we're thankful that we could be here. We ask, Father, that you would bless in the following services, and your leading will be our abiding. And we thank you, Father, once again, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen.